Father, I just thank you so much for who you are and that you want a relationship with us that is closer than anything that we can begin to imagine. But I thank you, Father, that you have imagined it. You've imagined it from before the beginning of time. It was always in your heart to be one with us. I thank you, Father, that your words will be what comes forth from me so that I'm able to express how you feel about us and what you're preparing us for. Thank you, Father. When God told me what I was going to preach about today, I said, oh, God, please don't have me preach on that. If there is any area in my life that I feel like I have been a failure in, this is it. What can I share with anybody in this area? And God said, this is why he wants me to preach on this today. It's because of his compassion. His compassion that wants to set me free. And he said, do you really think you're the only Christian that struggled in this area? He says, the whole body of Christ has struggled for years. Some of them know it like I did, but a lot of people don't even realize the bondage that they're in. But God knows. He sees the bondage. And just like that song that they sang last, I just can't believe they sang that song. Like I said, I'm going to have a hard time holding my emotions together this morning, but it's the secret place. God determined in Ephesians 1:4 that there would be a secret place for he and man to dwell as one. No separation. And the devil and even man in his own wisdom has done everything that they can to cause a separation. But God's compassion is alive and it's well. And he is going after us to persuade our hearts. It's the same compassion that Greg talked about a few weeks ago when he preached on Noah. It was God's heart for the people that caused everything that happened in the story of Noah. If God hadn't sent that flood, mankind was going to be destroyed, all of mankind. And God's compassion rose up and said, the man that I love so much, I can't let this happen. So this is the definitions of compassion. This is what Greg shared a couple of weeks ago. It's a deep awareness of the suffering of another, coupled with the wish to relieve it. God sees our suffering. He's seen this area that I've suffered in most of my Christian life. And his compassion wants to relieve it. He wants to set me free. He wants to set everybody free from it. It's a feeling of distress for the suffering or misfortune of another, including the desire to alleviate it. A feeling of deep sympathy and sorrow for someone struck by misfortune, accompanied by a desire to alleviate that suffering in mercy. God has called us, well, for many years, to pull down lies and to plant the truth in our hearts. And that's what this church has been all about since the beginning. And it's talked about in Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 10. See, I have this day set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. To root out means to tear away, to pluck up or pull up. To pull down is to beat, break, cast down. And destroy is to lose oneself and be void of. So this morning, God's compassion is gonna come forth to each one of us. And it's hopefully gonna pull out and root out and destroy and throw down the formulas and the self-focus that we've had on ourselves, the do's and don'ts, the things that we have to do or not do to be acceptable and pleasing to God. And God wants to plant freedom, his freedom in your hearts, his gospel of grace, and the faith of the Son of God, so that we're no longer noticing ourselves, but we're only noticing God. Now, when you have a garden, you know, I was telling somebody before church, you can take the children's church teacher out of the children's church, but you can't take the children's church out of the teacher. So, when you have a garden or a tree, if there is a problem, you notice the problem up here, don't you? Where the fruit would grow. Is that where you help the fruit when it has a problem? No, you don't. You don't go, oh, let me shine up that apple, or let me make it try to grow bigger. You go down and you find out what's wrong in the root system. What is the root system not getting? Something's wrong. So today what we're going to do, God's going to do it, He's going to cut away that old root system, and He's going to connect us to His root system. So anybody that wants ministry after, I'm in the mood to cut away some things. So the real problem isn't even the fruit, but we think it is, don't we? When we see something in our lives that upsets us, some behavior or action, we're all about the fruit. How can I change this? What can I do? We don't realize that we have to go to the root, not the fruit. Now, if you look at that, the root systems go deep and they're strong. And if you don't even realize that they're there and that they're supposed to be dealt with, you're going to start taking care of the fruit to the best that you can. Now, the root is the belief system. What belief system are you living out of? Such an amazing picture God brought to my mind this week. The belief system in a human being is the most powerful force in their life. And this picture shows a man from the waist up, he's a man, but from the waist down, he's a root system. And that's a picture of what really happens to us, even though we're not aware of it. The things that we believe are having the biggest effect in our life, whether we realize it or not. Proverbs 23:7 says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Many times, we're not even aware of what we're thinking. But you'll know whether it's good or bad because your emotions will let you know. I spent so many years of my Christian life in this vague feeling of guilt. And I never knew why. I didn't know what was going on. But it was because of a belief system that I had in me, planted in me, that God was watching me. And anytime I did anything wrong, He was unpleased with me. He was upset with me. We have two belief systems that we can live out of. And actually, what I'm finding out, as I'm hearing more and more of the true gospel, my belief system is going from the right to the left in one area after another. One area after another. You know, you would think that it just needed to be said once and it would cover all areas of your life. That's just not so. I wish it were that way sometimes, but I think that because of man's wisdom and how we operate, each area has to be dealt with at a time in our lives. When we live in God's belief system, we know that we're already like God. We don't have to do anything to try to be pleasing to God because we already are. God is completely content with you, and He is at total rest with you and who you are. Now, when you're in Satan's belief system, you're believing that you're not like God, that you're not pleasing to God, that you must work to become like God, and that you must do everything correct to be pleasing to Him all the time. One says God is always pleased with you no matter what you do. The other one says that God's pleasure in you is conditional. And it's conditional on your actions, whether you're doing right or wrong. One will bring you peace and rest. The other will bring you torment and toil and separation from God. One tells us to listen to Jesus and Him crucified and what that says about us. The other one tells us to look at our actions and judge ourselves. And then let's just take it to the full extent. You know how Greg takes everything out. If we're doing that, we're going to look at other people. And we're going to judge them the same way we're judging ourselves. We'll judge them by their actions, what they're doing and not doing. So this morning, God wants to set us free in the area of prayer. Now, when you think of prayer, that is a totally God thing, right? I mean, it is. So how could we have struggles in a totally God thing? Well, after today, you'll understand what I'm talking about. Now, I want to just say something right up front. I am not coming against prayer. I am 100% for prayer. Prayer is an awesome thing. But when Satan's belief system gets intertwined and mixed in with our prayer life, it can bring more damage than good. Because what it does is it plants that root system deeper in our hearts that comes from the enemy. We end up in shame and in guilt. And we pull away from God even though we don't realize that we're doing it. And we're put into bondage. Bondage is being focused on ourselves instead of focused on Jesus and Himself crucified. It's being focused on ourselves and what we can do to please God or what we can do to get God to bless us. God's already blessing us, y'all. Regardless of our actions, He is always blessing us. Bondage is seeing ourselves differently than what God says we are. At a very early age, I learned that being myself would only get me a lot of punishment and pain. So at a very young age, I learned to not be myself. In fact, inside of me, what began to resonate was, I will be whoever you want me to be if you'll just love me. And that wasn't just when I was a child. That went into my marriage. It went into my relationship with my children. And it has been so strong in me because I was so sure that God was unhappy with me that I was supposed to be somebody else. I believed that whoever I was bad. Now, you might say you haven't had that problem, and I would say baloney. Because how many times have you tried to change yourself in any area? Usually multiple areas, right? Then that means there's somewhere in your heart where you believe you're bad. That does not agree with what God says about us. Chastisement comes before freedom. Now, in this church, we've learned a lot about chastisement. Chastisement is not being punished. It's not being separated from God. Chastisement is being told the truth. And it can be painful sometimes because sometimes we're used to doing things our own way, and you have to first admit that you're wrong before chastisement can have its work in you. We must be willing to let go of our own thinking, the belief system that we've had that's wrong. We have to quit relying on our own flesh and just accept that Jesus did it all for you already. He already made you pleasing. He already made you perfect. I know during the week I was upset about something, and Becky's very perceptive. I don't need to say a word, and she knows something's going on. So she brought me this little page, and she had written on it, imperfection equals perfection. And I just started laughing out loud, because it's the truth. When I'm weak, He's strong. You know, so what do I have to be afraid of being weak? That's when His power is going to move through me the greatest. And that's what He wants to do. So even though we might feel a little uncomfortable when we're hearing the truth and it doesn't agree with what we've believed all our lives, after we get more and more free, freedom won't frighten us so much. So I'm laying a little bit of groundwork. Y'all are going to hear some things that you've never, ever heard any place before. But God wants to dig up some of those belief systems that have produced death and bondage in our prayer life. So he's going to cut out the wrong belief system at its root. And we're going to sow God's belief system in our hearts concerning prayer. You know, as we've learned more and more about God's dream and desire for his own life, it helps us to see the truth more clearly. Do you think God would possibly set up standards and principles for us to obey in prayer, knowing that those very things would make us self-focused and feel shame and guilt and then cause us to pull away from him, when the whole idea of prayer is to get close? Of course not, he wouldn't do that. So today we're going to take care of some of those things. First, I want to talk about what prayer is. There are several different words for prayer in the Bible. I just took this one. This one is from James. It's a preposition of direction, a strengthened form of forward to, toward, by the side of, nigh unto, the secret place, a motion towards, accession to, or nearness at, and then to pray to God, to supplicate, to worship. So prayer doesn't have to be words. It often is and it can be. But it can just be the communication and the fellowship of God in your heart, enjoying God. Now, this morning, I'm going to share my prayer life with you this morning, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I'm going to show you the two different belief systems that were operating in my life and how it affected my relationship with God. I didn't get saved until I was 25 years old. There was a reason for that. I thought God hated me, and so I hated him back. So I never prayed to God. My idea of prayers was memorized prayers, like the Hail Mary. Those of you that are Catholic know what I'm talking about, or used to be Catholic, you know what I'm talking about. So I prayed rosaries to Mary because I felt like I didn't have a chance with God. God hated me, but maybe if I could get on Mary's good side, maybe she'd go twist Jesus' arm a little bit and get him to do something for me. And then, praise God. You know, God worked in my life so many times, even while I hated him. I hated him as a very small child. I went through a lot of abuse, and I was taught that it was God that wanted that to happen to me. And so I did what was normal in the human heart. I hated back. And so I had a very hard time through a lot of my life. But at age 6, God healed me of a deadly disease. At age 10, God supernaturally protected me in a situation where somebody was going to kill me. And then 2 weeks before I got saved, he worked in, I guess I'm going to share it. About 2 weeks before I got saved, I was really desperate, y'all. I was in the middle of a nervous breakdown. Sometimes I knew my name, and sometimes I didn't. I would have panic attacks so bad they'd last for hours. I couldn't hardly tell when one ended and another started. I didn't know it was a panic attack. I didn't know what it was. And so I went to many quacks is what I did. You know, the more desperate you are, the further out you'll go to try to get help. So after that was all over, I was really ashamed, and so I didn't want to go talk to the Catholic priest, but finally I went and talked to him. It was one evening, and it was a little bit starting to get a little bit dark, and I went and met with him, and he told me, he said, "You're just going through a hormone change." I had a 9-month-old baby, and he said, "You know, some people have that for a long time after they have a baby." Well, the first place I went to was the doctor, and I didn't have any hormone problems. And so I knew he was wrong. And when I walked out of that office, I can remember stepping down off of the threshold and looking up and saying, God, there is no hope for me except for you. Now, think about what I'm believing. God hates me. And I've hated him all my life, but I came to a realization nothing else was going to help me. And I had to just let go and let God. So I jumped in my car. I was very emotional. I took off and I went around the corner and I sideswiped the truck. Oh, what a beautiful way to end the day, you know? Sideswipe a truck. I thought, oh, Larry's going to be so mad at me. And I'm going to explain why in a few minutes. But it was like, this is just one more thing. Just one more thing to add on to all the things I've done wrong that are messing up our marriage. And I looked around and nobody was there. And I thought, maybe I can get away with this. So I decided I'm going to drive around the block a few times. And if nobody's following me, I'm out of there. So I rode around the block. It was getting darker and darker. But I noticed, you know, I was watching in the rearview mirror a lot because I was looking to see if anybody was following me. There was a light that came into the back seat of my car. And even though it was getting darker and darker outside, the light began to get brighter and brighter. Pretty soon, it filled the whole back seat of my car. It was a color I've never seen before or since. And I realized it was God. It was God. Not only did he know about me and he was with me, but he saw me hit that truck. Now remember, I'm thinking God hates me and he's punishing me every time I do something wrong. So I was pretty shaken up. So I drove back and I parked behind the truck and I waited for the guy to come out. I feel so sorry for that man. I was just a blubbering idiot. I was boo-hooing, crying, hysterical, because I just had God in the back seat of my car, you know. And I told him, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. I hit your truck. And he said, where? And where? The whole back end of his truck was all bashed in. And I said, over there. He says, no, come point to me where. I said, you don't have to get close to it. I can see it from here. And he says, no, come over here and show me. So I went over there and I pointed it to him. He says, lady, is that where you hit my truck? Oh, yes, that's where I hit your truck. I'm so sorry. He says, lady, I was in an accident 6 months ago. And that's where I got hit. You're free to go. I'm not holding you responsible for the damage. That would be the first time I was going to hear the gospel. The first time God knew what it would take to open my heart for what I was going to hear in the next 2 weeks. I definitely hit the truck. No matter what damage was there, I'm sure I added to it. But that man was willing to just let it go and let me go home free. What had started this whole thing was on January the 1st, 1977. We were living in California at the time, and Larry came to me and said God told him we were going to move back to Louisiana. I did not want to move back here. This is where all the abuse had happened. Somehow, I thought if I ever came back here, maybe it would start up again. Just a childhood fear that I'd always had in my heart. And I also didn't believe that God spoke to people, so I thought he was the crazy one, that God had told him to move back here. Sorry, Larry. By January 9th, 8 days later, I was in a full-blown nervous breakdown because I was so afraid of moving back here. Most of the time, I didn't know who I was. I had hives on my body. And I had to ask Larry during the week. You know, sometimes a lot of time passes and you either forget the severity of something or you embellish the severity of it. But these hives were like baseballs, the size of baseballs all over my body. They were on my face. It was so bad sometimes that all you would see was two little peepholes for eyes poking out. No nose, just huge lumps all over my face. I looked like a monster, and Larry would have to wake up my two boys and tell them I was their mom, I wasn't a monster, and not to be afraid of me. Jay was 4, and Greg was almost 1. These panic attacks would wake me up during the night, and I didn't know what to do. So I would run to Larry, wake him up, wake him up. And he had a very high-stress job. He worked at NASA, and they were testing lifting bodies, preparing to create the space shuttle. I want to give you an idea of how stressful his job was so that you don't judge him for his actions towards me. They would take that lifting body, which is the aircraft right above the arrow, and they would attach it under the wing of a B-52 bomber. The pilot would take that B-52 up to about 50,000 feet and then drop that little aircraft. Then the aircraft, the little lifting body, would fire off its rockets, which would cause it to ascend to 80,000 feet. Then it would be out of fuel, and it would begin a rapid descent with no propulsion other than gravity. From the time the B-52 bomber dropped the aircraft until it was on the ground was 3.5 minutes. 3.5 minutes. Now, Larry was in the control room, and he was part of the team that helped that pilot land safely. He had to be strong and alert. He couldn't go into work half asleep. So he didn't appreciate me keeping him up all night for 3 months, night after night after night. So on March 8th, I woke him up again, and I told him what was going on. I need help. I need help. And he said, I can't handle it anymore. He said, I'm going to give you a choice. I'll give you a divorce. I'll put you in a mental hospital, or I'll send you home to your parents. And he said, the choice is yours, and I want the answer tomorrow. Don't wake me up again. Wow. You talk about feel alone. Really alone. So the next morning was March 9th, and I had some choices to make. What I didn't know is that was going to be the best day of my life. Somehow when I woke up, I felt compelled to call a Baptist pastor that I had heard speak on motherhood the year before. And I was really impressed with how a man could know so much about motherhood. And so I thought, well, I'll go see him. They gave me an appointment for 3:00 in the afternoon. I was so bad off that I had to ask them to send a couple of ladies from the church over to stay with me. Because by 3:00 that afternoon, I might not know who I was again, much less that I made an appointment at 3 with this pastor. So they sent 2 ladies over to the church that stayed with me and took care of the boys. So I went and I met with this Pastor Myers. When I walked in, I was very defensive. I said, I'm Catholic. Will you still help me? And he started laughing. I told him my situation. I told him what was going on. I told him what Larry said to me during the night. And he leaned back and he laughed. And I got more upset. And I said, either you haven't been listening to me, or you don't care, or you know something I don't know. And he said, oh, I know something you don't know. And I said, well, I need you to tell me what it is. He said, you only have one problem. And I said, no, I told you I had about 15. And the biggest one is I'm going to be separated from my husband and my kids. And he says, no, you only have one problem. He says, you're praying to the wrong God. He said, Mary never died on the cross for your sins. Mary never took your place. Mary never came and washed away all your sins. And he said, Jesus did that for you. And he says, Jesus wants to come and set you free. And he says, all you have to do is believe it, and it'll happen. And I said, You telling me all I have to do is believe what you just said? I said, man, I've been praying 3 rosaries every day and it hadn't done anything. And he says, like I'm telling you, you've been praying to the wrong God. He says, if you believe that Jesus has already done it for you, he said, everything's going to straighten out. So I prayed and I told God that I was at my wit's end and I couldn't do anything else. There was nothing more for me to try, and I was just going to trust that he had done everything for me, and I was just going to let him have my life. It doesn't matter the words that I spoke that day. That pastor, he just had me pray whatever was in my heart. And I prayed what was in my heart. And do you know, within 15 minutes of leaving that place, the cloud that had been over me for 3 months was totally gone. I knew my sins were gone. I knew I was just like God. I knew I was holy. And I knew God was pleased with me and he was living inside of me. I had heard the true gospel. And I believed it 100%. I was so set free. I didn't have to try anymore. I could just rest. I didn't have to try to be good anymore. I was good. My life totally changed that day. Even the colors. It was like there was a veil or a film over me that I didn't know existed. But the grass was greener and the sky was bluer. And it wasn't my imagination. It was like I was seeing things clear for the first time in my life. The depression left. The oppression left. I was flooded with peace and joy. I had no fear of failure. And no fear of God. I could feel him living inside of me. And for the first time in my life, I knew I was not bad. God's love began to flood through my being. And it gushed through me. Anybody that came near me, I couldn't contain it. I was telling them how much God loved them. Because I realized that he loved me that much. He loved everybody else the same way. That was my first experience praying with God. Wow. That was March 9th, 1977. In the following days, I would wake up early in the morning and I would jump on my bike when it was still dark and I would go and ride my bike for maybe 10 or 15 minutes. And my heart just gushed to God. I gave him everything I had and he gave me everything he had. It was wonderful. I treasured those times. It was the secret place where he wrapped his arms around me and I knew we were one. The rest of the day, I would just spend time basking in his presence. I had 2 small children. There was a lot of housework, cooking, but I was in constant communication with God. I was either singing songs to him, I was talking to him, or I was just enjoying his presence. The communication was constant. I want you to remember that. Because it's going to come up later. The communication with him was constant. I couldn't have stopped it if I tried. It was no effort of my own. It was God flowing through a heart that had no shame, no guilt, no belief that there was anything wrong in me. Greg was almost a year old at the time. He was already talking a little bit, saying, Mama and Dada. Well, out of my mouth, these words would come that I didn't know where they came from. I remember one day, I had this huge jar of pickles, and I dropped it on the kitchen floor. Now, normally, I know what I would have said, but out of my mouth came, praise the Lord. And I thought, how did that happen? Praise the Lord. I was saying that all the time. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Within a couple of weeks, my little baby is saying, praise the Lord. It was coming out of him effortlessly too. Now, he would say, pray the Lord. But every time I said it, he would say it right after me. My heart dripped between ecstasy and amazement and excitement as I continued to experience God in this way. I knew he was so happy with me, and I was so happy with him. It was like there was an open highway between he and I, and his love was just pouring into me 100%. The hives were gone. The oppression was gone. And my marriage was healed. Now, 2 weeks after I got saved, I had gone out for my little bike ride like normal. And when I got in, I was going to go jump in the shower, and I realized the hives were back. I'm talking baseball-size hives. I got so afraid for a minute. But a friend of mine had been talking to me about the power of the Holy Spirit. And I just kept blowing her off because I was having so much fun with Jesus and God. I didn't need the Holy Spirit. I didn't understand yet. You see, I had so little theological understanding, but I knew what I had, and I knew it was good. So immediately when I saw the hives, I thought about what she said, and I said, Jesus, I just ask you to fill me with the Holy Spirit and give me your power. And he told me to point to the hives and tell them to leave. I did it, and they left. I went, whoa, this is amazing. Within a couple of months, I started praying in tongues. That was effortless too. One day I was just praising him, and then all of a sudden it went from praising him in English to praising him in tongues. And I found that that prayer language brought me so much joy and peace, especially when I didn't know how to pray. I could not get enough of God. I tried to find every Bible study, every prayer meeting there was, because I wanted to learn about this God who was so wonderful to me. Now, I want you to remember, my prayer life up to this point had no limitations, no rules, and no bondages. I was free, and I was just myself with God, and I knew he was 100% happy with that. Then when I went to these Bible studies, they started teaching me that you should really pray first thing in the morning. Now, that didn't cause me too many problems because I already prayed first thing in the morning. But it planted this little doubt in my heart. What if I didn't pray first thing in the morning? Then that meant that maybe God wouldn't be pleased with me. And it started a wrong root inside of me. It was the same root I had grown up with all my life as a child. Satan's belief system, believing that God's pleasure in me depended on what I did and what I didn't do. Then I found out, when I went to another Bible study, that I should be praying for an hour every morning. At the time, there was a movement that was coming about, and everybody in the body of Christ was encouraged to pray for an hour and use the Our Father to do it. That was a little harder for me. I had two small children, and I didn't get much sleep at night because of that. And Larry would leave for work early in the morning, and I basically could just get in 10 or 15 minutes before the boys woke up. The fence around my heart began to grow more. When I went to God in prayer, before I even started, in my heart I believed he wasn't pleased with me. I knew it couldn't be an hour. The time bondage was bad enough, but in addition, I was taught about my quality of time that I had to have with God. That meant in a room all by myself. All of a sudden, this wonderful time that I had with God, where I knew I was totally pleasing to him, and I was totally pleased with him, was gone. When I went to God, I began to feel guilt and shame. But it was subtle. It was down in my heart. I couldn't have even put my finger on it about what was causing it at the time. But I felt like a little girl that was dressed in rags. And I went to a wedding, and I didn't know I was dressed in rags, but when I got there, somebody told me I was. And so somebody told me that what I was doing with God wasn't good enough. And so my little bike ride for 10 to 15 minutes stopped because God wasn't pleased with me anyway. My 10 to 15 minute bike ride didn't please God. I was a disappointment to him. I tried to get up earlier so I could do it, but even then I didn't feel the same joy and peace that I had felt before. I felt burdened, obligated, and fearful because I wasn't going to be able to pray long enough. And the worst thing happened. That gush of love that was between God and I, constant, 100% of the time, dwindled away slowly over the next year. Now I had to find things to pray about. It wasn't just a natural communication between God and I anymore. Then I was taught that I needed to confess my sins first before I started praying. Because you see, when you come to God, you come and you've got sins. Well, I didn't think I had any sins. Wasn't that what I believed God for, that God had taken care of all that? And so then they told me, well, no, 1 John 1:9. And until Greg preached on that scripture in this church, I believed that I was supposed to confess my sins to God before I started praying to him. So what does that do to a person when you do that? It makes you focus on yourself. What have I done wrong? What happens when you do that? You start feeling shame. You start feeling guilt. You want to take a few steps back from God. And I did what you all do. You know, I'm no different from you all. We all have things that we wished we could have gotten rid of 5 years ago, but they're still there. And you start saying, God, I'm so tired of telling you the same thing. I am so sorry, but I did it again, and I did it again, and I did it again, and I did it again. And every time I would say that to him, more guilt, more shame, more of a pulling away from him happened. See the little girl? She's still in that free meadow, but she's not free anymore. God didn't change his opinion of me. Nothing changed in God's heart, but what happened was things changed in my heart. God's belief system never changed, but my belief system moved from what God said about me to what the devil said about me. I struggled for a few years, but after a few years, I didn't even want to pray anymore. I would wake up in the morning and I would dread that I had to pray. And that scared me. I began to wonder, have I lost my salvation? Why don't I want to be with God anymore? The belief system in a human heart is the most powerful force in their life. When I first got saved, my belief system about prayer was based on freedom and God's 100% pleasure in me. I knew he loved being with me, and I loved being with him. But now, I thought God was unhappy with me. Now, there was a little glimmer of hope. I could still pray in tongues in some freedom. I couldn't pray in tongues as long as I wanted to. But you know, I didn't have to worry about what I was saying and not saying because I didn't know what I was praying. And so I would get a little bit of peace and joy there. But then we went to a church that said if you were in leadership that you had to meet every Saturday morning and pray in tongues together for an hour. At first, I thought that was a good idea. Like I said, I didn't realize what was going on in my heart. Oh, how neat. We're going to get together and we're going to pray in tongues for an hour. It didn't take very long for me to be in bondage again. Do you know how long an hour is? When you have to do something that isn't in your heart to do, and it's only an obligation, it's a very long, long, long time. And so then I had to do it because I was in leadership. And I want to say something right now. Those people are precious Christians. They love God very much. It's what they've been taught. They think they're helping us get closer to God. But all it did was make me feel inadequate. I felt shame and guilt. And I had to admit to myself, I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to pray in tongues for an hour every Saturday at 9 a.m. What's wrong with me? Why don't I love God? Why don't I want to be close to God anymore? Finally, I couldn't take it anymore. I thought, I shouldn't be in leadership. You know, this is a sign I shouldn't be in leadership. So I went to somebody in the church and I told them what was going on. And they said, oh, don't worry about that. It's just that the honeymoon with God is over. Now it's going to be work. At first, what you had was effortless because you were just a baby Christian. But now you're going to have to put out effort. And that's just normal. They said, you just need to push through and pray even though you don't want to. I did that for years, and I was not any happier. I didn't feel any freer, and I was a very unhappy Christian. But I never told anybody else except my husband because I was so ashamed. And even though I was afraid I was losing my salvation, the fear and the shame was just so strong in me that I couldn't share it with other people. Every now and then, I would have a breakthrough. And I love praying with people. So there were highlights in there. But when I had my time with God, my heart was sick. Now, the gospel has never been about man seeking to please God. Not even in your prayer life. That isn't what it's about. Prayer has never been about man trying to please God. Prayer is God coming and filling us up. It's a two-way communication. It's experiencing our oneness with God that already exists. And prayer should be born out of joy and desire that comes from believing that you are already acceptable to God. But for me and for many people in the body of Christ, prayer has become a system of works where we try hard to please God. My time with God was hardly ever flooded with joy and love anymore. Every few years, I would go to my husband in desperation and I would tell him what was going on. I said, I don't want to pray. You know, he had so much wisdom, but I couldn't receive it. But he said, if you don't want to pray, then don't. It might be another year before I want to pray. I can't do that. Then for sure I'll lose my salvation. That is what I went through as a Christian for years. And whether you realize it or not, unless you've been set free in the last 3 years in this area, you probably have some part of this going on in your heart. Might not be as bad as what I experienced. I think part of the reason I felt it so deeply was because of what happened to me when I was first saved. I felt that 100% communication with God. And when it was over, I knew something wasn't right. So today is the day that we can pull works out of our prayer life. We're going to look at these beliefs in a carnal way and see how absurd they are. Because sometimes, even though I'm hoping you all have all experienced what I'm talking about, I'm going to put it in a way so it's so absurd that you're going to never want that false belief system in your heart ever, ever, ever again. What if somebody told me that my husband really, really, really would like me to put a red ribbon in my hair before I talk to him? Now, I really want to please my husband. I want him to enjoy my presence, so I'm going to put a red ribbon in my hair. What if I went to another Bible study and they told me, if you really, really, really want to please your husband. Let's see if I can get this off of here. There it is. If you really, really, well, it may not come off. Okay. If you really, really, really want to please your husband, you should wear a mustache. Whoops, it's not going to stay. On your nose. Every time you talk to your husband. Then I went to another seminar, and I was told that he would really like it if I had a pigtail coming out of one side of my head. And so every time I went to talk to my husband, I put a red ribbon in my hair, a mustache in my nose, and a hair clip, so I had a ponytail coming out. How does that look? Isn't that absurd? The person that you're supposed to be one with here on this earth, you have to do all these things or they won't be pleasing to you. That's the same thing that doing that to prayer does in our hearts. It makes you feel like you can't be yourself. You have to go through all these things to be pleasing to God. Now, I'm no longer me. I'm Denise fake and pretend. I was not being me with God. I was being a pseudo-Christian. Now, God made every one of us different, right? He made even no two people with the same fingerprints. Do you think he likes different? Yes, I would say he likes different. He doesn't like the Stepford wives. That isn't what he wants. He wants everybody to be different. But religion and the church has said, oh no, we're going to be a little robot when we go to God. First, we're going to confess our sins, and we're going to confess them first thing in the morning, and we're going to pray for 1 hour. And we're not going to say anything about any of our doubts and our fears. We're just going to praise God and pretend like everything's okay. Do you really think that's what God sent Jesus on this earth for us to become? He loves us so much. He made each one of us different for a purpose. He loves us different. Cindy can please God in a way that nobody else can in the world. He has made her different and with qualities that please him like no other. It's true for each one of us. He has made us each one different so that we can be pleasing to him in a unique, unique way. God wants to spend time with the real you, not the fake you, not the one that believes you have to do everything right or you have to pray in a certain way. Or you have to do it at a certain time of the day or for a certain length of time, or God won't be pleased with you. God is thrilled with who you are. Until you let God persuade you of that truth, there'll be struggles in your prayer life. Because if there's anything in your belief system, in your heart, that's telling you that you're less than, or God is not pleased with you 100% of the time, then it's going to hurt your heart. I have started doing this, and I'm not suggesting that anybody else do it, okay? I don't want anybody else to try to do another formula. This is what God told me to do for myself. But every time I do something wrong and I blow it, that's what God tells me to say. God, I thank you that you're thrilled with who I am. With exactly who I am this minute. And I need to say it to myself to remind myself. Because our carnal way of thinking still says we're judged by what we do and what we don't do. Everything else in the world goes that way. You can't stay home from work and get a salary. It's based, sorry, Pat. You can't do it. Everything in the world is based on our actions, what we do and what we don't do. So that is always being fed to us. But God says, no. He is pleased with you just the way you are. God brought Jesus to the earth to show us who we are and what our value is. He died on the cross to die away that old man that said that I'm judged by what I do and what I don't do. It isn't how long you pray or when you pray. Or what time of the day you pray, or how you pray. Religion has made prayer stiff and formal, uncomfortable and oppressive. I want to tell you what prayer is supposed to be. Fun. Prayer is fun. That's what I had when I first got saved. I would wake up in the morning, and I was so excited because I was going to get time with my daddy. It was the best time of the day. That last song, I just have to tell y'all, thank you for that song. It was such a confirmation. There is a God who loves you, who wraps you in his arms, a place where you're changed. Not in your actions, in your belief system, in your heart. When you get with God, he will begin to persuade you of who you are. That's where you belong. Take me to that place, Lord, to that secret place where I can be with you just as I am. Just as I am. We got to sing that and pray it before. It's just like God was trying to persuade us before I even started talking. He wants to be with you. He wants you to know you're wonderful. He wants you to know he doesn't want to change you. Isn't that hard to believe? I'm going to tell you why. It's not the fruit that's the problem in your life. It's the belief system. If you think you're not like God, if you think you're not pleasing to God, the fruit that's going to grow up there won't be very nice. If you know how much God loves you, if you know you're just like God, if you know he made you that way and you're 100% pleasing to him, the fruit's going to be God fruit. God is not trying to change you. He wants you to be who you are. He wants you to know who you are, so who you really are will shine through. If prayer has become an obligation to you, there's no need to freak out like I did. It doesn't mean you don't love God. It just means that somehow works or judgment of yourself has crept into the relationship some way. So join the rest of the human race. The solution is simple. Take your eyes off of yourself. Don't think about when you pray, how long you pray, how you pray. If you're by yourself or you're not by yourself. The more you focus on how much God loves you and how perfect you are, your prayer life will just come up effortlessly, just like it did for me when I was first saved. And that's what has begun starting to happen for me. That desire to just talk to him all the time is starting again, effortlessly. All I'm doing is listening to how much God loves me. So focus on God and what he has said about you in Jesus. Shema, Shema. Keep listening to the true gospel. Don't let wrong teachings make you afraid to be with God. Pour your heart out to him. He loves it. He wants the real you. He doesn't want your works. He doesn't want you being like a robot. You're wonderful to him. You're precious to him. There's nothing you can do to improve who he made you to be. And you know what else? He's not afraid of your emotions. I was told, you know, you can't ever share when you're upset with God, that he wants you walking in faith all the time. Who's going to help me with those emotions if it isn't God? He's the one I got to go to get the help, because I can't help myself. So take off the works in the performance. Take off the red bow. Take off the pigtail. Be free. Be yourself. God has been waiting for this day. From the beginning, from before the beginning of time, God dreamt of a day that he would be with you, who you really are and who he really is. He's still waiting, y'all, because religion has come and it's messed up his plan. It's interfered. It's caused us to separate ourselves from him. So he is persuading our hearts through this preaching every Sunday so we can begin to trust that we really can be ourselves. We really can be ourselves. When we focus on who we are and our abilities, it causes unbelief to rise up. Now, just think about that, and we're going to apply that to prayer for a second. So you go into God because you need him to help you with something. But you're going to focus on yourself first and all the things you've done wrong, which causes unbelief to rise up, and then you think you can receive from God? He's got it right there. He's answering your prayer, but you can't receive it because unbelief is there. God wants all that moved out of the way. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, Jesus says, "Come to me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Now, it's easy. It's light. It's freeing. I'm going to give you the DLT version now. Denise's literal translation. Jesus is saying to us, all you that have been working hard at prayer, trying to pray right, long enough to be pleasing to me, let me give you rest. Let me refresh you. Just relax with me, for I am gentle and easygoing. I want to give you rest from your much trying. You can relax when you're with me. God is so full of compassion towards you. He comes to you to tell you to rest. When all the time, when you go to him, you're all tied up in knots about what you need to be pleasing to God in prayer so he'll answer your prayer. Wow, I'm glad I'm not on God's end. You know, that compassion has to just be coming up in his heart constantly for us because his desire is to have us so free. First Thessalonians 5:17. I want y'all to notice how you feel when you read that scripture. Pray without ceasing. How does that make you feel? It reminds me of how I felt when I went to all those seminars on prayer. It made me focus on myself and the fact that I can't do that. There is no way I can do that. And it's a command, so if I'm not doing it, God isn't happy with me. Now, if we read the Bible carnally, that's what we're going to get out of that scripture. When you read the Bible carnally, it means when you read the Bible, you are looking for or seeing what you need to do to make God happy. When you read the Bible that way, you're going to get Satan's belief system. And you're going to judge yourself and you're going to say, I can't do this, I can't do this, I can't do this. And therefore, I am not pleasing to God. It'll always show you that you're lacking something. And the clue to that is if when you read the Bible, you feel sadness and guilt, you're reading it carnally. If you judge yourself and feel bad about yourself, you're reading the Bible carnally. If we read the Bible and we do not see Jesus, and hold on your seats for the next statement. If you do not see Jesus and you having equality with him, then you're reading the Bible carnally. Notice what your first response was to that scripture. I'm sure it wasn't good. Now we're going to read it spiritually. The Bible is about God's love for us and what Jesus did on the cross for us. It tells us that we are just like Jesus, full of God's glory and honor with his righteousness. It tells us that God is always pleased with us. That is the foundation that we have to have in our heart before we read that scripture. This is what that scripture is telling us. It's saying that you can go to God continually without ceasing. His heart is always open to you. He is there for you without ceasing. He adores you. He never gets tired of hearing from you. Even if you're You know how, ladies, those of you that are married, you can tell when your husband goes off. He might, and he's trying, you know, he's trying to listen to you, but it's just so much he can take. God never tires of anything we have to say to him. He never tires of experiencing our feelings. The door of his heart is unceasingly open to you. You can go to him all the time. He wants to be one with you every minute of the day, in every difficulty. He never sighs when he sees you coming and says, oh gosh, here they come again. He is never, ever like that. This scripture is an open invitation from God's heart to yours. It is not a command. It also means that the formulas and focusing on yourselves about right and wrong, what you're doing and not doing, will begin to melt away your relationship, melt away in your relationship with God. When that happens, you will automatically be in communication with God unceasingly. It's not your effort that causes it. It's God in you. As your belief system believes more and more what God says about you and the pressure is off of you, your heart is going to be in communion with God nonstop. Not because of you, but because of God in you, communing with himself. For you see, you are the God kind. You are just like God. When you let his belief system have full play in you, you will pray without ceasing. When I first got saved, I was plunged into God. I was filled with the fullness of God, and I communicated with him constantly. I couldn't have stopped it if I wanted to. That never changed. That's the sad part. It never changed on God's end. But because I took on the wrong belief system, it changed in my heart. And it changed what I believed. And then the fruit that grew was that I wanted to pull away from God because I thought he was ashamed of me. It wasn't anything that I did that caused me to have that relationship with God when I first got saved. 2 hours before I believed God's belief system, I hated God. I didn't have time for anything to change in my behavior. The only thing that changed was my belief system. And I went from hating God to communicating with him night and day. It was God's love flowing through me with no obstacle, no fear, no guilt, no shame. And it was effortless. That is where God is taking you. He wants to have that constant communication with you because you want it too. It's just that up until now, you thought you had to do something to make it happen. And that's not true. So forget about your actions and what you do. Think about Jesus and what he's done for you. Think about Jesus and what he says about you. Do you know what he says about you? From the beginning, from before the beginning of time, all he wanted was you. His desire was to create you, someone that was just like him, so he could have a relationship with you, just like he has with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. That's what he wants. As you believe that you are as perfect as God is, and you receive the revelation that he enjoys being with you, the formulas of prayer will begin to fall off, and you will be praying effortlessly. And it will be fun. I'm starting to have fun again. It is so amazing, and I'm so happy. So, this is what I told God. God, I don't know how to tell him to pray. Why do you want me to preach this message? You know, all I can tell him is, don't do this, and don't do that, and don't. And he says, this is how you pray. Be yourself. Nothing else. Just be yourself. Total freedom. Whoever you are. It's not about right and wrong. Pray when you want to. Don't pray when you don't want to. Pray for however long you want to. Pray for how you want to. Pray for whatever comes up in your heart. Just talk to God. He loves you just the way you are. Matthew chapter 13, verse 44. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto treasure hid in a field, the which when a man hath found, he hideth, and for joy thereof goeth and sells all that he has, and buys that field. I was always taught God was the treasure. You are the treasure. You are the treasure. God found you, and he gave up everything he had. He gave up Jesus to get you and you and you. You are the treasure. Matthew 13, verses 45 and 46. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, who when he had found one pearl of great price, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. You are the pearl of great price. It's you. God was looking for a goodly pearl, and he found you. Hear it and receive it. Ask God to persuade your heart that it's true. I don't even know that we can believe it on our own. I think faith comes, we have to hear it, and we have to hear it. And that's why it's Shema, Shema. You have to hear it over and over and over again. Because the enemy is accusing you. You're accusing you. The people around you many times are accusing you. But God is not accusing you. Let him persuade your heart. Ask him to persuade your heart that you are perfect and complete. And when he looks at you, he's got a big smile on his face. Then you can be free in your relationship with God. Jesus died for us to have that. No limitations again. No rules. No bondages. He wants you free. He wants you to have that relationship. And it's the desire of his heart to have it with you. Father, I thank you for showing us that it was never your plan for us to have formulas. You never want us looking at ourselves and what we're doing or not doing. You only want us to enjoy us as we are. Thank you that you want us to come to you as we are, and that you like us. You adore us. Thank you for making us just like you. Thank you, Lord, that it's going to be you persuading our hearts that you are well pleased with us, that we bring you great joy because we're just like you. Amen.